आवाज नहीं आ रही सर।
सर साउंड नहीं आ रहा है सर।
Hello, now can you listen?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine, good.
Yes.
Hello. Good. So we'll start.
Okay.
Fine. I don't know why this admitting thing is coming. Okay, so we were doing intraoral radiography. Intraoral radiography means when the film is kept inside the oral cavity. So an extraoral radiography, you know, is OCT extraoral radiographs. Intraoral radiography is of three types: intraoral periapical radiography, then Bitewing radiography, and occlusal radiography. Intraoral periapical radiography, like we read last class, we have the tooth and the entire periapical area is seen by it is made of which techniques? The paralleling technique and the bisector angle technique. In paralleling technique, a film holder is used and the film is kept parallel to the tooth in the with help of a film holder, usually called Rin XCP film holder, and the film holder will have a beam indicating device which will help orient the X-ray beam in such a way that the beam falls at 90 degree to both the tooth and the film, and the radiograph is made. Here we try to keep the film as close as possible to the as close as possible to the tooth. The film, we try to keep the film as close as possible to the tooth. Then the second type of radio technique is, so the problem here is that most of the time we will not have the film holder, or it may not crystallize, means there is a logistic implications, and sometimes the anatomy of mouth prohibits the use of film holder. So there the film paralleling technique cannot be used. In such cases, we use bisecting angle radiograph. In bisecting angle technique, what we do, we keep the film in touch with the tooth, and the film and the long axis of tooth make a triangle. We imagine a line which bisects, we imagine a line which bisects the angle made by the tooth and the film, and angle the X-ray in such a way that the central ray falls at 90 degree to the imaginary bisector. This ends up in with us theoretically having two triangles in which one angle, that is the angle which is bisected by each, are bisected, so they are equal to each other. Other angle is 90 degree and the central line is common. So it ends up that the two triangles which are formed are equal to each other, hence the side which represents the tooth in one triangle becomes to the side which represents the film or the shadow of tooth on the other triangle. So they become equal in size. This technique is relatively comfortable in the sense that we do not need logistic requirement, that elimination, that limitation is eliminated, and the other limitation of mouth is also, anatomy of mouth is also eliminated. But the problem here is this is highly technique sensitive. Every time you have to imagine the angulation and you have to accurately do it, which may not be possible most of the time. So in that case, what we do that we have given some angulations. Angulations means for central incisors it is 45 degree, maxillary for canines 45, for premolars 30, for molars 20. Similarly for mandibular 10 degree, 15 degree, 20 degree, right? 15, 20 and then 10 and 5 degree angulations are given and the entry points are given. This was about the intraoral periapical radiography. Now today we will start with something called as Bitewing radiography. So let's see what is Bitewing radiography. So this is Bitewing radiography. Bitewing radiography was introduced by Howard Rapper. Okay. Bitewing radiography was introduced by Howard Rapper in 1924-25. Why it is called Bitewing? Because you see the film is taken. This is the X-ray film on which one wrapper is added and a film, a wing-like thing is made, something like a wing on which the patient's bite. Here the upper tooth will come, here the lower teeth will come, and from outside you'll shoot. So the X-ray ends up like this, the crown and some part of root, the crown and the interproximal areas and the alveolar bone is seen in both. So this is called as a Bitewing radiograph. Okay, this is a Bitewing radiograph. It has two very important functions. That is why it is helps in initial detection of initial interproximal caries and detection of secondary caries. Like this is a restoration here. So if there is a caries below it, it will be seen. And it also helps in progress of dental caries, and it also helps in assessment of alveolar bones, right? All the alveolar bone can be assessed from here. The level of the alveolar bone can be assessed. Fine. Then the it will help in the assessment of, so you should must write the indications for Bitewing radiograph as detecting dental caries, interproximal, secondary dental caries. Okay, monitoring progress of dental caries, assessment of existing restoration. Okay, then. Assessment of periodontal bone, that is prospective monitoring of alveolar bone crest and changes in the bone level. So if we are doing some surgery, follow-up can be done and can be done. And interproximal dental relationship and conducting large-scale radiographic surveys for prevalence of dental caries and periodontal disease. Most of time, in fact, many of the time, Bitewing radiography comes as a short note, or indications of Bitewing radiography usually come as a short note or as MCQ's question. So this is very important, Bitewing radiography. You must know that. Okay. What happens? Why it is helpful in large scale survey? That if we make periapical radiograph, in one radiograph, you will see only two or three teeth, or say four teeth. The caries usually occurs in the coronal area, not in the root. So we need to see only the crowns of the teeth. So in one Bitewing radiograph, we can see four upper and four lower teeth, right? So we can see eight teeth, which is easy to do this radiography to assess dental caries in mass population. We have to take survey 100 people by radiograph. If we do not have panoramic radiograph available, then the Bitewing radiograph is the easier technique. Okay. So This is how it is made. Bitewing radiography. The film is kept in such a way that it covers the crowns and the crowns of both the upper and lower teeth and half the root. And you can see a wing-like flap is kept inside the film on which the patients bite. Okay. For anterior teeth, the film has to be kept vertical. Can you see? For anterior teeth, the film is kept vertical. For posterior teeth, the film is kept horizontal. An angulation is given at a 90 degree and a slight negative angulation is given around 3 to 5 degree. For bitewing radiography also, the ring XCP holders are available. Ring bitewing holders are available for the bitewing radiography also. Okay. Can you see slides now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. It is not changing. Fine. So a slight angulation of 5 to 8 degrees given. Fine for the bitewing radiographs. That is because of the angulation of the teeth are there. So this is how a film is kept, a wing is kept. Since the person bites on that wing, it is called as bitewing radiograph. It is used using a tab attached to the film like this or a bite. This is vertical adult. You can see the pictures. Huh? Or this is how a tab is kept and the radiograph is made. Okay. Sometimes the holder is also used. If you do not, the advantage, it is simple technique. It is inexpensive. You don't need any holder. You can just use a tab in case. You can have disposable tabs can be used and child can be done used in children also. Okay. The disadvantage, it is arbitrary, does not accurately reproducible when the film holders are not used. Okay. When you use a film holder, this is how the film holder looks. It is called as a ring bitewing holder or unibite film holder. There's so many different types of holders are there. You can just omit them. And with the film holder, the radiograph can be made like this. See the same way a film is kept. It has a beam indicating device or a ring indicating device like this to which the film is attached and the radiograph is mazed. Okay. Now we'll come to, you can leave this. When we want to see the caries and restoration, then the film has to be exposed well with a good contrast. When you want to see the periodontal stages, the film has to be underexposed to avoid burnout so that the thin areas of the bones are not lost. Again, these two points are very important. They are frequently asked in the MCQs, both in your final year exam and in the NEET MD MCQs, that for caries restoration, what kind of radiograph will make, and for periodontal detection, what kind of radiograph has to be made. So note out these two points. So this was about bitewing radiograph. Okay, I'll move further. You can see how bitewing radiograph looks like. Looks like this. Okay. Okay. Now next radiography is occlusal radiography. Occlusal radiography is made when the film is kept at the occlusal level, means on which the patient bites. Right. Right now the film was kept either horizontal or vertical behind the tooth, either upper tooth or lower tooth parallel to the tooth. Now the films are kept 90 degree to the tooth in the occlusal level. Okay, the indication, I'll show you first radiograph, then you will understand. This is how the film is kept. If you can see this, the patient is biting on this, and this is how the radiograph is obtained. Okay, so this is what is called as occlusal radiography. You can see here, and the film is kept, patient bites on the film, and the film will have a white side and a colored side, and the white side is kept so at which the radiograph is to be taken and it is exposed, and now you see that all the teeth are seen in this, right? Can you see all the teeth are seen? So this is what is called as the occlusal radiography. We'll come back to now indications. So what would be the indication? The limitation of periapical radiography was one, that only few teeth were seen, not all the teeth were seen, one. Second, if the patient doesn't have a good mouth opening, we cannot make that radiograph. Now, In occlusal radiography, even if the patient doesn't have a good mouth opening, we can make the radiograph. How? Because very little mouth opening is required to insert a thin film inside the mouth. So we can make radiograph one. Second, large areas can be covered. The entire maxilla or mandible can be covered. Second. Third, the angulation is almost 90 degree teeth. You saw the radiograph. The angulation is different. So when a radiograph is required from different angulation or 90 degree angulation, the occlusal radiograph can be made. When once we reach further, you will understand this. So what would be the indications? Indication you need to precisely locate roots and supernumerary unerupted and impacted teeth. Suppose we have a impacted teeth or a unerupted teeth, which is lying in the, suppose a maxillary canine is there. We want to see where the canine is, how far from the roots. Then in IOP radiograph, it may not be covered. So in occlusal radiograph, we can see. Then to locate foreign bodies, somebody might have a bullet injury, somebody might fall down and some stone might have entered the bone or the tooth. In such cases, or a needle prick you would have done and the needle had fractured. Anyway, the foreign body can go. So in those cases, can be used. And to demonstrate and evaluate the integrity of anterior, medial, and lateral. Sometimes you can see also the maxillary sinus in this. Okay. Examine patients with trismegistus in the patients in which there is a no mouth opening. When you see the fractures of maxilla and mandible, then you can use this radiograph to determine medial and lateral extent of pathologies. If we have some tumor, then we can see how far it goes medially or laterally, means buccolingually or anterior posteriorly, how far is the lesion. In one peripatal radiograph, very few areas we come, but occlusal radiograph, we can see larger areas. And to detect the pathology in palate and the floor of the mouth, larger pathologies, if there is a palate, we can make occlusal radiograph because palate will not come in the IOP radiograph. And peripatal assessment of upper anterior teeth, especially in children, also in adults, unable to tolerate peripatal films. Fine. Now let's start how many different techniques are there. Maxillary and four maxillary and three mandibular techniques. Okay. I'll keep on going explaining and can keep writing down. The first technique is called as anterior maxillary occlusal projection. This is the first technique called anterior maxillary occlusal projection. In this technique, if you see all the maxillary anterior teeth have seen larger areas, bigger than peripatal radiograph, with a large part of palate, especially the anterior part of the palate. So if a canine is impacted, this side it can be seen. If there is a lesion in the floor of the, in the anterior part of the palate, it can be seen. The film is positioned in such a way that the white side faces upwards towards the tube and it is placed horizontally like this. Means the longitudinal of axis of the film is from one molar to the other molar area, and angulation is given. The central ray falls at the tip of the nose. And it falls at an angle of 45 degree. It forms an angle of 45 degree. The angle formed is 45 degree and at the tip of the nose. So for anterior maxillary projection, it is indicated for seeing the lesions in the anterior area, fracture of the maxillary anterior teeth, the anterior teeth in the children, larger peripatal lesions, larger cyst and tumors and pathology in the anterior teeth. Okay, when the posterior teeth are not clearly seen, to see the impacted tooth in the anterior area. See, all these indications you can just imagine, think and write. Okay, then how is the technique? The film is clipped. Okay, the film is placed at the occlusal side or the white side facing, placed in the occlusal plane with the white side facing upward or towards the tube. Patient is looking straight and the occlusal plane is parallel to the floor, and the cone is directed at the tip of the nose with the central ray being directed at the tip. See, if this is the whole thing is the tube, the center is coming at the tip of the nose, okay? Center is coming just above the tip of the nose and at an angulation of 45 degrees. This is how the anterior maxillary occlusal is made. Now the second radiograph is maxillary cross-sectional. See the difference. Now here all the teeth are seen. Okay. Now here all the teeth are seen. From molar to molar, all the teeth are seen. This is a cross-sectional radiograph, it is called. Here everything is same. The film positioning is the same. Only the angulation has changed. If you see carefully, the angulation is increased to 65 degrees. There we had 45 degree. And now earlier the position was at the tip of the nose. Now the position is the bridge of the nose. At this point is the central. The central ray is at this point, bridge of the nose. So there are two changes in this technique. The positioning is 65 degree angular vertical angulation as at the bridge of the nose. So here we end up with cross-sectional maxillary occlusal protection. This is the cross-sectional maxillary occlusal protection. The larger areas are covered in this projection. Okay. Now there comes a third projection, that is before that we'll come to maxillary vortex view. Okay, this is called as vortex view. This is also called as true occlusal protection. In this view, this is similar to cross-sectional view, but this is it is 100% 90 degree to the occlusal film. You can see that it is full 90 degrees. So if you want to see some fracture in the maxilla, some lesion in the mouth which moves from here to there, then we can use this radiograph. The change here is that the angulation is given at this point. This is called the vertex of the head. This is given from the vertex of the head. So this is called as the maxillary vortex occlusal projection. Cross-sectional projection is also called as true occlusal projection. It is also called as true occlusal projection. Many times the short notes, some older examiners will ask you true occlusal, or in the Viva or in the MCQs, they will ask you true occlusal projection. So cross-sectional maxillary occlusal projection along with the vertex view is called true occlusal projection. And anterior maxillary is called as the topographic. Topographic means only one surrounding area, so it is called as the topographic occlusal protections. And topography is of two types, anterior topographic and posterior topographic. So this is posterior or lateral topographic area. See the positioning of the film here. The film is kept, patient has to keep longitudinally in the mouth and shift it towards one side, the side towards which you want to make the radiograph. The angulation is at the level of the canthus of the eye, and this is around 20-25 degrees angulation. Okay, at a higher angulation, all the teeth, you can see all the posterior teeth are seen over here. This is called as lateral maxillary occlusal projection. See all the posterior teeth are seen. You will get all these things in the book called White and Farrow. You will get all these projections. Okay. So this was the topographic. So both maxillary and mandibular will have, according to older classification, the occlusal radiographs are of two types, true occlusal and topographic occlusal. The true occlusal view is the cross-sectional view, and the anterior projection and the lateral projection or the posterior lateral projection is called as the topographic view. So topographic is of two types, anterior and the posterior lateral. The maxillary vertex view also comes under the true occlusal radiography. Fine. Now, in this radiograph, in the vertex view radiograph, since a large area of the skull has to be crisscrossed, usually along with film, a screen is used. The cassette and the small cassette comes like extra radiograph. Cassette and the intensifying screens are used. Otherwise, the end ups like the clarity is not so good as, but it is a total true 90%, 90 degree view from this radiograph. Okay. Now we'll come to mandibular projections. Okay. So mandibular anterior view, also called as mandibular anterior topographic view. If you see here, the patient is now, the film white side is facing downwards. The film is kept in the same way, patient is biting on the film, but the white side is facing downwards and patient's chin is lifted. The aim of the radiograph is to give this angle, central ray should be at the 90 degree to the occlusal film. This we cannot do with the patient's chin tilted down. So we make the patient lift the chin. Patient has to look up. Okay, patient has to look up and then the angulation is given around 45 degree. Okay, this angulation is around 45 degree angulation, and we end up with a projection like this. All the mandibular teeth with the inferior border of the mandible and a larger the peripital areas are seen. You can see a canine, impacted canine is lying over here. So we can see where the canine is lying. This is what is called as the anterior mandibular projection or mandibular anterior topographic projection. Now, the next view is cross-sectional mandibular occlusal projection. Mandibular cross-sectional projection, and it is also called as true occlusal projection. It is also called as mandibular true occlusal projection. Now, the film is kept horizontally and white side is facing the film tube, and patient chin is lifted further. No, it has been tilted. Lifted further up, and the angulation is made at 90 degrees. Just below the chin, the entry point is there, and we end up a radiograph like this. This is what is called as mandibular true occlusal projection. And next projection is lateral cross-sectional view like this. Now we are taking the view from the lateral side. This is mandibular lateral cross-section. So this was about the occlusal radiograph. Okay. In endodontics, the small, a special type of adapter comes here with which we can make the radiographs. Okay. Fine. With this, we finish up the mandibular intraoral radiography. So, to sum up, intraoral radiography was the radiographic technique when the film was kept inside the mouth. We had three types of intraoral radiograph: intraoral periapical radiograph or IOPA radiographs, we had Bitewing radiographs, and we had occlusal radiographs. In intraoral periapical radiographs, the teeth and the periapical area is seen, okay, either maxillary arch or mandibular arch, depending on which tooth has to be taken. Usually for adults, adult size 2 film is kept for, and there are two techniques to make the radiograph, the paralleling angle technique and the bisecting angle technique. Bitewing radiograph is made when the both the upper and lower teeth, the crowns are to be seen. So it has basically 4 major indications: to see the interproximal caries, to see the level of the alveolar bone, to see the secondary caries, and for mass detection of caries in a larger camp or the community areas. Okay, Bitewing radiograph, when we have to detect the dental caries, we take with a good contrast. When we see the periodontal bone status with or alveolar bone status, we take with a lesser contrast. Okay, in Bitewing radiograph, a tab is made with a paper tab is made, like a wing is attached to the center of the film on which the patient bites, and both the half the film will be covered by the crown of the upper teeth, half the film by the crown of the lower teeth, and the radiograph is made by giving projection at the 90 degree to the film. Many times the film holder is present, which is called as the biting film holder, or it is ring biting film holder, which will have a beam indicating device and help in making the radiograph. Okay, then the second intraoral radiography is the occlusal radiography. Occlusal radiography is made when the film is kept in the occlusal plane. It can be of two types. It is usually indicated for the seeing the larger area of the jaws, to see the fractures of the jaws. Like in this case, if there is a fracture of the maxilla, it can be seen. Okay, here if there is a fracture in the mandible, it can be seen, which cannot be seen in the what you call that IOPA radiograph. Or here if a fracture is there, it can be seen. If there is xylolith here, it can be seen. Yes, the mandibular true occlusal view is used to detect the xylolith of the submandibular gland, where the exposure is reduced by 50 degree. The exposure is reduced by 50% to see the xylolith of the floor of the mouth or any foreign object in the floor of the mouth. Fracture, if it is shifted to right buccally or lingually, can be seen. If there is an impacted tooth or a tumor, it is there. From where to where the tumor extends can be seen. If there is a tumor buccally, there is a buccal expansion, there is a liquid expansion, everything can be seen in this. Next, we will start with the normal radiographic anatomy, and then with the interpretation of realize that. Okay. So, in such cases, the occlusal radiographs are made to detect the larger areas, to see the larger pathologies, to see an impacted or unerupted tooth, to see the fractures, to see the buccal or lingual displacement of fractures, to see the xylolith and the submandibular gland, to see the impacted or unerupted teeth. Okay, for these the occlusal radiographs are made. Occlusal radiograph, according to older classification, are of two types: true occlusal and topographic occlusal. According to recent classification, it is anterior view, then cross-sectional view, and the posterior lateral view. The anterior and the posterior lateral view are called as a topographic view, and the cross-sectional views are called as the true occlusal view. Maxilla will have one additional cross-sectional view called as the vortex view, from in which the radiographic exposure is given from the vortex. Okay. So with this, we finish up the occlusal intraoral radiography. This is a very important chapter. Lot of questions come. Most of the time, one short note will be there from this chapter, or MCQs will be there from either of these three, either IOP. Please read it carefully. Okay. Bye. Thank you. If you have any doubts, you can always ask me. Okay. Tomorrow we'll start with the next chapter. Okay. Have a nice day.
Have a nice day.
Thank you, sir.
most beautiful.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes, bye. Keep
thank
reading.
You.
Thank you, sir.
Do not waste your time. And yes, one more thing. Okay, chalo, continue. Bye.